Good morning, everybody. Just a short introduction about myself. I actually studied at Politecnico di Milano, but currently I teach at Politecnico di Torino. How can we call it ourselves? Managerial engineer, ingegnere gestionale. So I have a given perspective on the internet. So I've got some sort of bias. So you just want to be aware of the sort of bias and perspective that I bring to the table. I also focus quite a bit on retailing, so that's the sort of perspective that I bring to the table today and I want to share with you. Also, as you can hear from my accent, I do have quite a bit of an American accent, so from time to time I might not be, might be hard to understand me. So feel free to stop me at any point in time whenever I'm not being clear. Also, the objective of today's speech is to share knowledge. So if anything gets in the way, if I'm not being clear in any sort of way, just feel free to stop me at any point in time. Also, I will try to involve you in a few discussions over here. Let's start with what we're not going to talk about today. That is, we're not going to talk about pure information services. So I don't want to talk about when internet just provides the information to the consumer, okay? So we're not going to spend a lot of time talking about Google and those stuffs, because there we don't have the atoms. We don't have some products that we can manage and use in a different way thanks to the internet. We'll just focus on where the bits, information technology, meets the atom, that is, interacts with some sort of product, okay? So that's, we are not going to talk about the internet per se, but just when it just changes the way we use things, okay? Let me start with the agenda. I know it's Friday, so you talked about many things, and there might be quite a bit of overlap. But in case there's any excessive overlap, you just want to let me know and we'll skip some issues here and there. Let's see the agenda. First, let's, I just, as a managerial engineer, ingegnere gestionale, we focus on the economics of things, how things work economically, okay? So we talk about the long tail. I know you talked about the long tail quite a bit so far, but we'll then talk about inventory costs. So what's driving the economics behind the long tail? What makes the long tail such a powerful economic phenomenon? But also I want to talk to you about how the long tail interacts with consumers that actually bring value to the long tail, just associate economic value to the long tail. Then we're going to talk about the infinite tail. The infinite tail is basically the infinite sort of choices that consumers have when they customize products, okay? Not in the first case, consumers choose among a very large set of options of products. In the second case, consumers design their own product. So there's not even a limited number of products we can deal with. Basically, the number is infinite. It just depends on how consumers can think about new products. And then we're going to talk about fixed costs, spare capacity, and two-sided markets. Basically, fixed costs, just to give you an idea, is the cost of an empty house. A house might be worth hundreds of thousands of euros, and we'll figure out that 11 million houses in Italy each and every day are empty. And we'll figure out what the internet can do to leverage on this huge potential to generate value on the one hand, and to host people that want to spend a few days in another city. And then we just close our discussion with internet and supply chain in rural India. I know nobody's from India. I guess there's somebody from Pakistan, isn't it? Or there should be. The thing is, we always think about the internet as something that has got to do with the Western world, with the United States. Actually, I wanted to show you how the internet changed the life of farmers in rural India. It actually changed the way they live, okay? Let's start with the first item, that is inventory costs, long tail, and consumers. Probably the most boring part of the presentation, but still. I want to share you how things work on the long tail, okay? Let's start with the economics of retail. Basically, retailers, traditional retailers, have three assets. I actually work in the retail industry because it's a fairly simple one. You basically have only three assets. The first one is the brand of the retailer. say the brand Zara is worth several billion dollars, just the brand. The name has got something magic, and it's got the meaning to us. Then we have space, that is stores and warehouses. And then finally, we have inventories. That's with these three elements, you can build a retailer. Okay, am I being clear? So the thing is, inventories is one key ingredient for all retailers. According to how well you manage your inventories, you generate or destroy value, okay? And when you manage inventories, there are two things you wanna focus on. One is the margin, how much money you make on each transaction when you buy and sell goods. You wanna buy at 50 and sell at 70 in order to gain a $20 margin. Am I being clear on what the margin is? Is the difference between the price at which you sell the good and the price at which you buy the good. Am I being clear? And then we have another thing is that is inventory turns. How quickly and how often you use your inventories, okay? If you turn your inventories 12 times a year, it means that you buy a good and sell it in a month. That is, you hold it just for 1 month before you sell it. And that means that basically with one unit of investment, you turn your inventories 12 times a year. If you only turn your inventory once a year, that actually means that you buy it on basically January the 1st, hold your inventories for 365 days and sell it only on the last day of the year. That means that you make the transaction after you held your inventories, your capital investment for a long period of time, okay? Let's see an example just to focus on the functions of economic functions for the company of inventories. let's say you buy an item for $50 and sell one unit of that same given item for $70. But you sell one unit in a whole year, okay? So you basically buy it in January and sell it in December. That actually means that at the end of the year, you make a $20 margin out of a $50 investment. Am I being clear? That actually means that you have a 40% productivity of inventory investment. Am I being clear? So you make $20 in a year out of a $50 investment, okay? How can we possibly improve this situation where we have a 40% productivity? There are basically two strategies retailers can follow. The first one is a so-called profit path, that is you increase your margin. Rather than selling it at $70, what is that? $70, you sell it at $100, okay? So rather than making a $20 margin, you make a $50 margin. You still turn your inventories only once a year. You sell your unit once a year. But each time you sell it, you just make more money. It's so-called the profit path. You make more money out of a single transaction. In this situation, you increase your the productivity of your inventory investment from 40% to 100%. The second way around this problem is to the so-called the inventory turns path, or the turn path. In this case, rather than trying to sell your product for more, you sell it more often. Basically, you turn your inventories 10 times a year, so you reduce the price a bit. Rather than selling it at 70, you sell it at 60. Am I being clear? So each time you sell it, you just make a $10 profit. But you bet on the fact that demand will increase sharply, and you will sell your item not only once a year, but 10 times in a single year. So basically the idea is that you buy at 50, you sell it at 60, then you rebuy at 50, you sell it at 60, and so on and so forth for 10 times in a year. So you have a $50 investment that actually generates a $10 return each time you turn your inventories. So you have a 50% investment during the whole year, and you make $10 10 times. So you have a $50 investment, and basically over the whole year, you have a $100 margin that you make. So a net effect is that at the end of the year, you have a $100 margin, and you have a 200% productivity for your inventory investment. Am I being clear? So you could either turn your inventories more fast, or you can make more money out of a single transaction. So turning inventories very fast actually makes one of the crucial assets for retailers much more productive and your company much more effective. Am I being clear? So the way you use it inventories is crucial. let's look at the economics of the long tail. When you look at the traditional brick and mortar store, actually when you think about it, inventories there perform two different functions. One is what I call the display stock. The products, they are there just to generate demand in order to excite you about the product. A clear example about this is the front window. The goods that are in the front window of stores are there just to excite you, to drive you into the store, to get you excited about the product. They're not there to be sold. They're there to attract you to the product and to the store. And then you have what we call the logistics stock that is there just to fulfill demand in order for you to get it and take it home. Let's look at this shelf of Coca-Cola products. When you look at this picture, this is the first row is display stock. All the goods behind the first row is logistics stock. Okay? The first row is there to attract you and show you, hey, we have a you have the option to buy Coke Zero. The other one behind that are just logistics stock. They're to fulfill demand. And we have to keep in mind that in traditional stores, inventories perform both functions, attract us to the store and to the product, and enable us to get the product immediately. Am I being clear? So the thing is, when you enter different products, these two products are jewels from the Lucia collection from Bulgari. Well, you know what? We have a problem because the display stock is huge. And the number as compared, this actually depends on the number of stores. This actually depends on the level of demand we expect. In this case, when we have products whose cost is roughly $10,000, understandably, we don't expect much of a demand for those products. But Bulgari has got tens of stores. So if you just want to display the product in the stores, you have like 60 units for 60 stores, whereas you expect to sell only 10 units a year. Actually, at the end of the day, you make a 60 units investment in order to generate just a 10 units volume in demand. And all of a sudden, when this happens, basically you're left with 6 years of supply in your stores. You have a very bad investment in inventories. Because in order to show the product to the consumer, you need 60 units, but out of those 60 units, you only get 10 units in sales. That means that your inventory investment is actually a very bad one. Because the volume of your demand is too low in order to support the investment in just the display stock for your chain of 60 stores. That's actually a real example I encountered in my professional career, okay? So these two functions are always performed by inventories in stock in the traditional stores, but these dynamics make it very inefficient for traditional stores to have slow-moving items, to have to carry products whose demand is too low, okay? Because the display stock just kills you with tons of inventories, you basically will never sell. But on the other hand, if you don't have the display stock, you will never see this demand, okay? So when demand gets too low, it's very hard to carry the product in traditional brick and mortar stores. E-tailers actually can perform the same function that is display the product in a much more efficient way. They just use pictures rather than units. And when each unit is worth thousands of euros, that's a decent saving for an e-tailer, for an internet retailer, as compared to a traditional brick and mortar retailer. Any question so far? Am I being clear? So e-tailers do have an advantage in terms of display stock as compared to traditional retailers. Am I being clear? Second thing is, I will just briefly take you through some basic inventory models to show you that on top of this, we have some other advantages. Let me show you. We said we have an advantage in terms of display stock. I will show you that we also have an advantage in terms of display logistics stock, okay? On the stock that we use to fulfill demand, not to generate demand. Let's look at the this magic formula. I don't want to take you through the details of the formula, but the idea is very simple. Say you have a warehouse or a store where you have a given demand D, okay? And each time your supplier delivers to you, you pay a given fixed amount A, okay? Each time the truck delivers to your store, you pay a given fixed amount A, okay? And it, but this means that you don't want to get small deliveries because each time you get delivered, you pay A, okay? The flip side is that if you buy in large quantities, you also have a holding cost for inventories. Inventories generate a financial investment that generates a cost to the company. You need to have the warehouse where you hold the products, okay? So the more you have inventories in your warehouse, the more you pay. But on the other hand, if you don't buy in large enough quantities, you will pay a lot of money to your supplier that needs to deliver each and every day. On the one hand, you can get delivered each and every day. You will pay a lot of money for the delivery. On the other hand, you can be delivered very infrequently. You will buy in large quantities, and your warehouses will be filled with inventories. You need to find the sweet spot between these two extreme scenarios, okay? You need to find the right quantity that balances these two costs. On the one hand, you don't want to pay too much for the deliveries, but on the other hand, you don't want to pay too much for the inventory cost. Basically, the idea is that there's an optimal quantity. That's very easy. The cost for this optimal quantity is there. So the optimal quantity actually depends on how much you sell, demand, D. It also depends on what's your fixed cost, on how much your supplier charges you each time you get delivered, and how much it costs for you to hold your goods in your warehouses, okay? That's a basic... There are many assumptions in this model, but I don't want to get into the details. The idea is that your cost depends on how much it costs to get to be delivered, how much demand you have, and what's your cost of your inventories, okay? Actually, this means that as a function of total demand, you can see here, on the x-axis we have total demand, on the y-axis we have the total cost. As demand increases, the cost of your inventories increases, but it doesn't increase linearly. There's a square root of demand, okay? That actually means that this is the total cost of your inventories, but when we look at the unit cost, that is the total cost divided by the number of units you sell to your final consumer, the total cost of your inventories goes up, understandably. What's more interesting is that the unit cost of inventories goes down. So the larger you are, the lower the cost of your inventories. So here's the trick. If you have two retailers, one is a retail that sells one unit per store and has 50 stores, that retailer with 50 stores that sell one unit has got this cost of inventories. If you compare this retailer with another retailer that has got just one single warehouse where it sells same 50 units, and just with a website, this retailer would be right here. The cost of inventories for the e-tailers that concentrates all the demand for all its customers on a single warehouse and a single website faces this cost of inventories. Whereas another retailer with 50 stores with one unit in demand per store faces this high cost of inventories. So there's good reason for to concentrate demand in a single warehouse when you have slow moving items. Because your cost of inventories basically with a central warehouse would be here, whereas with many small stores, your cost of inventories would be here. And that's basically why for slow-moving items, you have the advantage of holding all your inventories in a central location, okay? So that's why internet retailers, the largest internet retailer, Amazon, started with books. That's a category where the average book sells less than once a year per store. So all the bookstores were here, and basically Amazon went down here. Thus gaining a huge advantage or in terms of inventory management over traditional stores. Okay, am I being clear? Okay, there are other reasons why you have advantages of carrying inventories in one single location. I just want to skip this. In the interest of time, it would take us a bit of time to discuss this. So internet retailing concentrates volume at one location and thus enables to generate economies of scale. And the second thing is risk pooling, but I want to skip that. These phenomena improve the productivity of a very significant asset, that is inventories. So retailers only have three assets, and concentration of demand in one single location just improves display stock and logistics stock as well, thus making one of the crucial assets for retailers much more productive than in traditional brick and mortar retailers, especially for slow moving items. Just want to show you a few examples of this phenomena. This is Brick Arms. It's a company that sells weapons for World War II compatible with Lego characters. That's their business. Who has played with Lego in the past? Who has played with these weapons from Lego? It's a very slow moving item, right? An item that basically hardly anybody wants. So the question for you guys, and this is another example, this is a Sherman tank from World War II. Lego doesn't sell this stuff. They basically sell the components that are required in order to generate this stuff out of standard Lego product plus some specific components. You can get this. But you can't buy this from Lego, okay? So two questions for you guys. Why doesn't Lego sell this product? There's clearly a demand for this. And Lego is clearly a long tail company, a company that sells thousands of different, we call it stock keeping units. SKUs stands for stock keeping unit, different items. Lego is very good at managing a huge variety of items, but still doesn't get to this level. Where you sell Sherman tanks or gun machines from World War II. Any idea on why Lego doesn't sell these stuffs? First question is, second is, Lego is very keen on the Lego standard. They want to protect the Lego system, but still they are okay with these guys. They don't take them to court. Any idea on why? First question is, why doesn't Lego sell the Sherman tank? It's slow moving even by Lego standards, right? Its demand for that is too low in order for Lego to benefit significantly from these stuffs. Sure. The one reason is the turnover is not high enough for Lego to care about this stuff. There's another reason though, the content. Lego does have Lego products about wars, but not contemporary wars. It's either back in the past or way out into the future. It's okay to have a Star Wars Lego product. They have medieval wars products, but they don't have any contemporary war products, okay? They just don't want to be that sort of product. But still, there are people that like to play with small figures about war. Many, I guess, then kids play with that. I can see you nodding. I did it. I played with little soldiers. And Lego says, well, you know what? If these guys can make a decent amount of money by doing that, and they will help me to keep some of my consumers engaged with Lego in their when they turn 11, 12, 13, and 14, probably I got a more loyal customer. And that customer might sooner or later buy larger Star Wars product, which is exactly what I did during this Christmas season. I bought some Lego Star Wars products for myself. Actually, I could carry them here, but I didn't think about it. But I still in these days buy Lego products. I play with them with my kids, actually. But It's interesting to see how the long tail has, is playing a role. Any other category you can think of where the long tail, that is the huge amount of different variants, can be offered on the internet, other than books? Books is the classic example. Any other product category which with huge variety? Food is one category which with some problems, because you want to be careful on how you transport food. Clothing and shoes, which is fairly related, closely related to clothing. This is Zappos.com. Have you heard about Zappos before? Zappos is the website that basically changed the shoe, the online shoe retailing. Actually, in Europe, we know Zalando. Zalando is actually not the original idea. Zappos is the original idea. They Zalando just copied here, copied it in here in Europe. About the fact that it's this whole story is about the long tail. Just for men's shoes, they have 17,000 different stock keeping units. No single brick and mortar retailer can afford to get any close to this, any way close to this. It's unaffordable from an inventory investment standpoint for any traditional retailer to get even close to this number, okay? But I want to share with you some ideas on the fact that this is the value they create for consumers, huge amount of options to choose from. What's the drawback from this? Say you enter a store with 17,000 different options to choose from. Clearly, there's a better pair of shoes for you than in any traditional retail, brick and mortar retail store. What's the flip side of that? Speak up. You will never check all of them. You know there's something good for you out there, but you don't know how to get it, right? So actually, consumers, when faced with this huge variety, very often feel they don't want to make a decision. I just want to show you one experiment from the marketing literature. You have a supermarket with one promotion on the shelf, and you have six fruit jams to choose from. 30% of the customers stop in front of the shelf, and 30% of the customers buy. Am I being clear? So when they walk by the shelf, 40%, 4 out of 10 stop, and 3 out of 10 actually buy. Let's see what happens when you increase the number of options for consumers, okay? When you increase the number of options from 6 to 6 plus 18, that is 24, actually the consumer attention is drawn to the category. Consumers pay more attention to the category and stop in front of it. However, only 3% of those buy the product. Actually, it's much harder for the consumer with a larger variety to choose the item. Actually, for first it's hard. Second, we have what we call in economics regret. That is, the consumer actually, it's exactly what your colleague said. That is, your consumer knows that out there there's something good for him or for her, but actually it's not clear which is the best option. And given that I know there's a best option, but I don't know exactly which is the best option, I just wait and postpone my purchase, which is not exactly what you want to do, right? So on the one hand, you can create variety, but as we can see here, variety has got a very good feature. It attracts consumers, but it has a bad feature, that is, it makes it harder for consumers to actually purchase and buy. So what Zappos did is what you can see here, a very simple, you can see that the look of the website is very basic, right? It's not fancy. There's nothing special about the Zappos.com website. It couldn't be more basic. One thing they have, though, is it makes it very easy for consumers to navigate the products, to choose which products might be relevant for them. And think about it. They have all these product features you can select. That is size, the length. In the United States, they also have the width of the shoe, okay? Then you have the product category, like athletic shoes, you have the brand, you have the running shoes, then as education, you have the blue one, and so on and so forth. Tell me one thing, what is the, among all these dimensions that this product features, which is the one you won't be willing to substitute on, that is the one you really, really want to have right? Size, right? Not only they give you the option to navigate among the 17,000 items, they also tell you, you know what? These are the two dimensions that actually consumers care the most about. So the first thing I want consumers to tell me is the length of their the feet and the width of their feet. Then I'm going to show them only those products that fit on them. I don't want to tell my consumer, you know what? You could have this nice pair of shoes. Unfortunately, I don't have it in your size. Right? That is exactly what happens, on the other hand, in our brick and mortar stores. So we have variety, but we need to figure out a bright way to let consumers navigate through our variety. Okay? Let me ask you then one thing. What are other problems you have when you try to sell shoes online? You have many options, and you need to tell consumers how to find the best one. Any other problems do you think you have when you think about buying shoes online as compared to brick and mortar stores? Any problems you might face? Speak up. You can't try it, right? That's a very significant problem. And indeed, I guess it's the first one in the agenda here. It's a touch and feel product and you can't try it. It's just, you don't just need to see the picture, you want to try it because you want to touch and feel it, but you just have the picture. You have the display stock in the store to try it. In the on the website, it's just an image, and it's just not enough. Anything else? That I put it here in touch and feel. You need to feel it and try it, okay? Just retry, but basically different word for the same concept. Anything, any other reasons why you might prefer the traditional brick and mortar stores? Not exactly what I want. Anything else? Yes. It's the people side, Robert. I know that for engineers it might be hard to understand, but people do like people. It's very hard for me to understand it, but I see it in my wife, okay, which is not an engineer. When you enter the store, actually there's a one magic word that we call the shopping experience. When I buy a pair of shoes, I tell my wife, can you please go buy one pair of Clarks in my shade of brown, which is Testa di Moro, size 43. That's how I buy shoes. She just says, I'll go shopping. She thinks that shopping is an activity, and she even thinks it's an enjoyable activity during which she interacts with people, which is exactly why I hate it, right? Which is just amazing. There's no experience in shopping online, and also you don't have the information from salespersons, and you don't get immediate reward. It's another crucial issue. Who has just one pair of shoes that just uses, then when it's broken, you buy next one? Raise your hands. I'm an engineer and I probably have 10. Okay, but clearly we are a biased sample, okay? We are engineers, so we don't understand very well that thing called fashion, human beings and interactions. It's not our business, right? These are emotional products, believe it or not. It's what people like to wear, what people like to buy, okay? So these are problems. You have an advantage that is assortment, variety. But you have to face the fact that when you sell online, you do face problems. Consumers want to get immediately their new toy. You can see it in my wife's face when she gets home from shopping. She's excited because she has her latest toy to play with. It's basically a toy, and you just want to get immediate reward for your new toy. Let's see how they fix the problems, okay? And I want to share a video with you. The guy you see here is the CEO of the company.
Tonight on Nightline, one giant step. The economy may be struggling, but from strappy sandals to sexy stilettos, from cross trainers to Crocs, this shoe store is revolutionizing how business gets done.
From the global resources of ABC News with Terry Moran, Martin Bashir, and Cynthia McFadden in New York City, this is Nightline.
If you're looking for a certain pair of shoes, there's a warehouse in Kentucky that probably has them. They've got 1,000 brands in just about every style, size, and color. 4 million pairs of shoes. 24 hours a day, they're boxing them up and shipping them out to shoe shoppers sitting in the comfort of home.
Good morning, and thank you for calling Zappos.com. Where Elvis was once spotted in our warehouse, looking for a pair of blue suede shoes.
This is Zappos.com, and what Amazon did for books, Zappos is doing for shoes. They're trying to revolutionize how business is done and how people work. The name is an adaptation of the Spanish word for shoe. And this year, 9 years after going into business, Zappos is on track to sell $1 billion worth of shoes.
You will have these shoes on Monday with our free upgrade.
And they're having a party doing it. One night, it was a toga party. Work hard, play hard.
You guys ready to have a good time?
Yeah! Tour the Zappos offices, and there's a cheerfulness you won't find in the dour offices of corporate America.
Hey everybody, thanks for coming.
Every department has its own way of greeting visitors. Zappos is headquartered in Las Vegas, where they do have office carols like almost any other corporation. But right there in the middle, we may have missed.
Okay, so far you've seen the funny part of it, that is the American culture. That's not the focus of our presentation today, okay? I want to focus on the business side, the process side. How do they fix those problems consumers have? Let's start with looking at the CEO office. This is the CEO office, okay? This is where the CEO works like 14 hours a day.
Him. There he is, Tony Hsieh, the emperor of shoes, with no more office space than Dilbert.
One of the things that's really important for us, actually probably the most important focus for Zappos, is to make sure we have the absolute best company culture. And part of our culture is just having a family-like atmosphere.
And at times it looks like one of those internet startups that disappeared when the bubble burst.
Go!
Here's the entire finance department racing Pinewood Derby cars in the office. But unlike those failed startups, last year Zappos made a 5% profit. Not bad.
And in multiples, how many times more than a call center worker do you make?
I don't have a calculator, but my salary is $36,000 a year. So I think some of them make more than me.
Some of the people in the call center make more?
Yeah.
Of course, he can afford it. Just a few years out of college, Hsieh sold an internet company to Microsoft for $265 million. But you wouldn't know it.
How many pairs of shoes do you have?
I probably have about 10 pairs right now, but prior to Zappos, I used to have one pair that I would wear for 2 years until it had holes in it and then buy the same pair again.
So you're not that into shoes?
I'm not that into shoes.
What he's into is building a company where people love to work and customers like doing business.
We just want to be about the very best customer service and the very best customer experience.
Selling shoes over the internet would seem difficult. People want to try them on, see the size and color. Zappos overcame that with free shipping, both ways. Order as many shoes as you like. You have a year, 365 days to return what you don't want.
Okay, and then once we get it back in, it can take 48 hours to process back in, but we'll refund you for the $41.
And if they treat the customers well, they do pretty well by the employees, too.
Free food is always available in the cafeteria.
So even the snacks are free. We go E5.
There we go.
Almond Joy.
But that's nothing. The company also pays 100% of medical and dental benefits.
Why in this world is it such a revolutionary idea to treat your employees and your customers well?
Yeah, I think just because you don't really see the payoff right away. You see the payoff, you know, a year, 2 years, sometimes 3 years down the line.
It's a great day here at Zappos. This is Stephanie. How can I help you?
At the heart of the Zappos revolution is the call center, where actual human beings answer the phone.
Hi, Patty. How are you doing?
Correct. A lot of companies have learned that they can be rude to their customers, they can give them bad service, they can even not answer the telephone, and people still have to do business with them.
Right. And right today, that's because they don't really have a choice.
How can I help you today?
95% of Zappos' business comes over the internet, but they spend a lot of time and money training people to talk to customers on the phone. There's a 4-week training course that every single employee, from the executives on down, are required to take, even if their jobs don't usually require talking with customers.
Well, I'll be happy to help you out with that. Do you know your order number?
Oh, yes.
You don't know your order number. Okay, no problem. Do you have a phone number that would be on your account?
Sari Levine already works in the design department, but she was a member of the latest call center class. And just before they were hired, she and the rest were offered cash to walk away.
We are actually increasing the offer to $2,000, but today is the last day where you can choose it. We offer them money to trainees to quit because we really want to make sure that people that are working at Zappos are truly passionate about the company and this is the place that they want to be.
Very few take it.
Are you ready to get started? Yeah.
For the graduates, there's a ceremony. Pomp and circumstance, diplomas, the Zappos pledge.
I'm on a Zappos mission to live and deliver wow.
I'm on a Zappos mission to live and deliver wow.
Armed with core values, I'm going to start now.
Armed with core values, I'm going to start now.
They actually do have a list of 10 core values to work by.
Create fun and a little weirdness.
It's just a fun way of saying that we really respect and celebrate everyone's individuality.
Pursue growth and learning. Do a lot of people tend to get kind of stuck?
I think it's just really important for people to feel engaged. They always need to feel like they're learning and growing.
I noticed immediately coming in at the graduation ceremony and people are smiling and laughing and clapping and making jokes, but you're very reserved.
Yeah, and that's part of what I mean when I say I'm not the one that is saying, okay, here's what the culture should be.
Well, why isn't your phone center in India?
Because we don't think you're going to be able to give great customer service by outsourcing it. And for us, if customer service is what our brand is going to be about, then you can't outsource that. If a customer is looking for a specific pair of shoes and we're out of stock of their size, say, everyone here is trained to look on at least 3 competitor websites. If they find the shoe in stock on the competitor, direct the customer to the competitor. And
what do you get out of that? Somebody else sells the shoes?
Yeah, we lose that sale.
What they get, they think, is customer loyalty. 75% of their business is people who come back. And part of their training is exposing employees to every part of the business. Remember Sari Levine? After finishing her training at the call center, she's now shipping shoes in Kentucky.
So it tells you that you're looking for a Rockport, and your last number is going to be 3184. Part of the training program, we call it KY Boot Camp. We go to our Kentucky fulfillment center, and you understand every single aspect of how the warehouse works.
Now Zappos is branching into things like clothing and electronics. They're not stuck on shoes.
And so we'll listen to our customers and try out different suggestions. They've even suggested cookware. So we're selling cookware.
So you have customers who like you so much, they just want to do business with you
almost no matter what it is they're buying.
Yeah, we have received emails from customers that have asked us to start an airline, and you know, we're not going to do that this year, but 30 years from now, I wouldn't rule out a Zappos airline.
In that case, you'd probably have to pay for shipping. This is Brian Rooney for Nightline in Las Vegas.
Okay, let's see how they fix these problems. Let's look at what they do and how that relates to the problems of internet online sales. How do they fix those problems we have identified? How they what practices try to solve the consumers' problems that actually the internet online sales generate? How do you relate problems from consumer side to practices in the company? Back and forth. So it's I guess it's the first one. Free shipping. Keep in mind that all these solutions are very expensive. Their return rate is 30%. Cost of shipping is 17% of the total turnover, which is just zero for a traditional retailer, right? Why does it does it make any sense? I can very well understand the free shipping one way. I pay shipping because I want to deliver to the consumer. Why the hell do you want to pay for the shipping the other way around? When the consumer sends you back the product and then you refund the consumer in 48 hours, why does it make sense to give consumers an incentive to return your products and rush to give their money back? Does it make any business sense here? Actually, at Zappos, they did the math. And those consumers that return the most are the most profitable ones. The more you return, the more you're profitable. Because when you buy, when you ask Zappos to ship 10 units, you probably just want to buy 3. But I know how it works with my wife, and you know, when she plans to buy 3, she's guaranteed to buy at least 5, right? So that's exactly, okay, it's expensive, but if you fix the consumer's problems, then consumers tend to reward you with volumes and loyalty. Keep in mind, 70% of the business is done with repeat customers. That actually gives the company great potential for growth because consumers tend to be back. If you have a given volume of consumers, but you always need to find new one because the old ones are upset, sooner or later you run out of customers. If your customers keep coming back, you just need to find new customers to increase the volume of your total sales. Because they, once they try it, they will be back, okay? Any other things that impressed you in terms of practices and relationship with the problems we've identified? The call center. 90% of the business is done online. Still, they have a 24/7 call center that is in the United States in these days legendary. The maximum duration of a call at the call center in these days is more than 10 hours. What's your experience with normal call centers? When you call Vodafone, say, or any telecom company, what's your experience with the call center? Do they just enjoy spending time with you or just rush? They just tend to rush and it seems like you're wasting their time, right? They have no time limit for consumers. Their idea is when in a retail store a consumer talks to a salesperson, that's good news. Because the personal relationship is part of the business and they rebuilt this at the call center, okay? Not only they have the call center, which they call customer loyalty center, don't take calls, they take customers, which is a different way of saying the same thing, but just delivers a message. But the other thing I want to focus your attention on is how they treat the people at the call center. What strikes you about how they manage their people at the call center? Come on. Didn't you notice? Is that what you're expecting in the company you will be working for when you graduate? What strikes you as different or from the standards. Keep them happy. Why is it? Does it make any business sense? It is expensive. They spend a lot of money on their people. Happy customer, happy employees in order to have happy customers, right? To deliver service, if you interact with a person that is not in a good mood, you probably don't get a good service, right? Anything else that impresses you on how they manage their people? Unusual practices and how they relate to the customer loyalty center and consumer experience. They pay people to walk away. They say, I pay people to walk away from me. Why does it make any sense to pay people not to work for you? It's very clear why you want to pay people to work for you, right? Why does it make sense to pay people not to work for you? Just speak up. Well, first you said the expectation. When you say no to $2,000, basically you're telling yourself, my job is actually worth quite a bit of money, right? You're telling yourself you don't want those money, you want to keep your job. And so you're motivated because you're telling yourself, my job is worth some money. The second thing is selection. You find a very cheap price, $2,000, to make sure that people that are not motivated don't get to talk to your very precious people, that is your customers. You don't want people that are not motivated to talk to your customers. It just costs $2,000 to make sure that that doesn't happen. Many companies have adopted these practices, okay? Also, in terms of media reward, they promise 48 hours delivery, but actually they deliver in 24 hours. Speed of delivery is actually a crucial issue, and this increases significantly the cost of their warehouses. Still, they don't care. If it takes the extra dollar to make the consumer happy, they're willing to do that. And also, in terms of information to consumers, they get information from consumers, but also they have a very good website in terms of technical information, actually run and buy shoes online. And online at Zappos, I get much better information on my shoes than I get in normal stores actually specializing in running shoes. So when you look at this, you realize that they do have an advantage because they can carry a huge variety. But the internet per se just delivers one advantage but creates all sorts of problems. And if you don't fix those problems somehow, just the internet kills you rather than makes you make money. Just to give you an idea, this company was sold to Amazon for $1.1 billion, okay? So the value creation is there. Not only the experience, the funny part, the whistles, and so on and so forth, this company created value for $1.1 billion with these practices, okay? So to fully leverage on the potential benefit of the internet, you must figure out how to solve consumers' problems with the internet that actually are there, okay? I'll skip the third one, and we'll talk about the second and the fourth. The economics of the infinite tail. There's one difference between what we've seen so far, that is a given limited number of products and mass customization. I want to show you one example here that is MMNs. You all know the MMNs, right? The little stuffs, okay, with chocolate. You can customize them with your own picture, with your own words. They promise immediate delivery in 24 hours, and you can use whatever logo you want to have on your customized MMNs. Just to give you an idea, this is the price tag you pay for a standard set of MMNs. This is on the Esselunga website, okay? These are the MMNs for my third daughter's birthday, which is tomorrow. My daughter is Penny, that's how we call her, and this is her picture, okay? Any idea on the price, the value that customization generates? The standard ones are $2.39, that is roughly 10 euros per kilogram. Any idea on how much that is worth? That is basically the same product, but customized. Can you capture the difference? It's not many more options, different colors. It's a customized, product that simply was not there before consumer interaction. Okay? Any idea? It's so 50% more, 100% more than the standard product. 200% more, anything, any idea? 30% more. Anything, any other number? 100% more. Anything more? 5% more? It's 10 times. This is actually the cost of this stuff. This is 30 euros worth of products. But you know what? It's if I give my little daughter as a gift that stuff to the left, I have a problem. She's got a bit of a character, okay? If I give her this stuff with her picture on it, she's going to be happy about it. Again, it's an emotional product, but the value of it doesn't actually lie in the MMMs. It's the, actually the 90% of the value lies in customization, okay? And actually, you can take a look at it. You can't eat it. But if you want, it's actually the product that is in my hands, okay? I want to show you some logics on when customization can work, okay? When this idea that you customize, you design the product to consumer needs, not only you give them more choices, you design the product to consumer needs when it works. First is when consumers actually do have different needs. When you think about just eating chocolate, that need is not specific. Gifts are specific. And so you can see on the website that it's all about gifts, okay? Events. Also, you need three ingredients to, that is the value creation. Consumers have different needs. How you generate the value? First is elicitation. That means that you need to figure out a way for consumers to tell you what they want, okay? That is, we lower the picture in the case of MMMs, right? In this case, basically, you have four different options. Like you put your name or your words on the MMMs. Then you select, say, the color of your MMMs. Then you have another mechanism to, in order for consumers to tell you what they want, that is reaction to prototypes. You show consumers a prototype of what they want so they can figure out whether it's actually what they wanted. Then you have physical measurement. Think about a product category where customization can actually add a ton of value. Can you think of a single product category where consumers do come in different shapes and thus have different needs? Any idea? Clothing is actually a very good product category. Then you don't need to only understand what consumers want. Well, can you see it? No. Not only what consumers want, but then you need to manufacture what consumers want. That is, you need to have a flexible production system that can manufacture according to consumer needs. And there's also one little detail about customization that is back to inventories. When I have a huge variety of standard items, I can buy them in advance, keep them in a warehouse waiting for consumer orders, right? When the product is customized, I can't hold it in stock. I need to print those MMMs when my daughter's birthday is approaching. You can't hold them in stock and manufacture them in January because you know that Penny's birthday is coming in March, right? You need to wait for my order in order to manufacture it because I, at the very latest moment, I want to figure out the words that I want to use, okay? And then you need to have logistics because you want to make sure that my MMMs show up at my place. What if you have the right MMMs, but then I get a picture of another daughter? Then again, I have a problem with my daughter and with my wife as well. Okay, let's look at these mechanisms in place with a startup from Politecnico di Torino, okay? It's called Lanieri. It's a very nice startup from Politecnico di Torino, and so I want to spend a few words on that. First of all, there is the identification. They ask you whether you want to put any word, in this case, my name, in the inner side of your jacket. So one thing they do to customize is use identification, okay? And they put it there. Then they have selection. an incredible selection to choose from. They have 35 bottoms, 26 linings, 9 colors that add up to 10 million possible combinations. How can you possibly choose among 10 million combinations? What I do is very simple. If you select a given fabric for the jacket, they don't let you choose among the 36 bottoms. They tell you, well, with this fabric here, the bottoms we think will fit best are those four. So that you can have both the wide assortment of the internet, but then an easy shopping experience as well, okay? So you need to design the process. You just don't need to offer options. You need to design the process the consumer goes through. Same thing applies for the inner lining. That is, this inner part that needs to fit with this outer part. Given that I chose this color, they say, well, we have many options to choose from, and you can choose from all the options, but these are the four that fit the best, in our opinion. So make it simple for you. Then they tell you, let's see the prototypes. They send you samples of the fabrics you are considering to buy home. But they do it in a very smart way. They tell you, well, you can choose any sort of samples you want to try at home, but you will have to pay a price for it. Because the risk of a free shipping of free stuff is that a huge number of people that actually, at the end of the day, not that interested, will buy it and maybe try the samples and buy it somewhere else. What they do is to make consumers pay, but then they do something else. They tell consumers, well, you know what? We'll send you the 5 samples. We'll let you pay, but we'll also give you a discount card that in case you buy the finished product, we'll give you a $10 discount on the finished product. So again, think about how they design the process and how they design the incentive of consumers in order to get from consumers the right behavior. That is, consumers are right. They want to try and feel the samples, like in Zappos. But you know what? I want to make sure that only those that are actually interested in the product take the samples from me and you try the prototypes, okay? And then the physical measurements. You can have the online self-service measurements, and then you can also have the stores. There's a nice video, I don't want to waste time with it, but they ask you to take 18 measures of your body in order to figure out what sort of suit you need to have. But they also have physical stores where you can go to and have a professional person that takes your measures, okay? So pure players, what we see there is this company started as a pure online company and is opening stores. And actually, it's exactly what Amazon is doing. Amazon is opening stores in these days. So we see that online players are opening brick and mortar stores as much as traditional players. Walmart is planning to spend $2 billion for the internet online sales, okay? So we are at the situation where the two worlds of traditional retailing and online retailing are converging. Actually, there's a very important concept that I want to share with you that is the multi-channel retailing, what beats me the atoms, that is consumers can choose any channel they want for 4 activities that consumers tend to perform, that is get information, maybe from the call center, maybe from the website, when I want it, how I want it. I place orders either online or at the call center or at the stores. Then I pay whichever one way I want, at the delivery, online with my credit card, online with PayPal, and then I ask for whatever means of delivery I want. I can pick up my product at the store. I can pick up my product at the delivery point. I can get my product to be delivered at the store, at my place. Let's keep this in the interest of time, and let me go to the last item in my presentation. Let's see. I just want to show you this slide. To show you how we can use the internet for to have a great business opportunity. What you see, what can you see in this picture? One thing is cars, a parking lot. What I see here as a management engineer is idle capacity. A lot of resources that are idle, cost a fortune, and are idle and not doing anything. If we figure out through technology a way to make cars more productive, then we have a very good business. That is, this is the breakdown of cost of a car. And you can see that variable cost of a car only account for 39% of the total cost of ownership. 60% of the cost of a given car are fixed. That actually means that if I have two cars used 100 hours a year, the cost is 200. If I figure out one way to use a single car 200 hours a year, then the cost doesn't lead to 200, but only to 140. You still have the $60 of fixed cost. You have twice the variable cost. That means that the total cost doesn't go to 200, but with a single car used more often, the cost goes to 140. If I figure this out, I can leverage on this huge asset and make more money. And this is the example of car sharing activities. You just figure out a different way to use the car more often, but the key idea is basically economic. You just observe a huge capital sitting idle in parking lots. And you don't want that to happen. You just want to figure out a way to make idle investment more productive, okay? I want to just mention the fact that the same thing applies to number of seats on a given car. You have the same problem. That's idle capacity. That's the transportation capacity that is not being fully utilized. I was driving from Milan to here this morning, and I was seeing long queues of cars moving from the northern part of Lombardy to Milan. I bet some 60 to 70% of them at just one person. That's a huge value. There are four empty seats. And what's the incremental cost of an extra person on board? Basically zero. It's for free. If we can figure out a way to use more seats in a given car, there's a huge value we can generate. And clearly, the value is generated in this car, case by BlaBlaCar, but it's basically an economic phenomenon. The extra cost of an extra person on the car is basically zero. Everything is already paid for. If I can figure out a way to fit an extra person on the car, there's a huge value to leverage on. I want to skip the rest, and I just want to... part of this has been covered. I want to just spend the rest of our time just talking about rural India. I just want to focus on this example because it shows you the power of the internet when it's coupled with other concepts in an unusual environment. We talked about Zappos in the United States. We talked about Lanieri with clothing in Italy. I want to talk about rural India, okay? Just a few pieces of information on the context, okay? Has anybody been to India? What's it like? What's it like? Anything that impressed you during your trip? People everywhere. Ton of people, yep. I'm going to talk about this specific state in India, that is Madhya Pradesh. It's a rural region. Actually, the size of the Madhya Pradesh is equal to Italy. So we're basically talking about a country. The number of people is 20% more than Italy, okay? So just in a region of India, we have more people than in Italy, okay? Literacy is 69%. So 30% of the people can't read and write. Hindi, not English. I mean, 30% of people can't read and write. Population employed in agriculture is 260 million in India. It's 1 million in Italy. So agriculture is a big deal. Productivity for agriculture is extremely low. It's one-third of the standard, the global standards. And they have a very specific social infrastructure that is called the Chupal, okay? The Chupal is, in any given small village, is an event that happens at night when people get together, very often at the home of the leader of the village, okay? And let me just show you what a company did about this, okay? Let's look at the way things used to work about agriculture in India. This is the market. You can see that this is soya beans, this is the market. And one thing that happens in the market, all the producers get to the market to just deliver the products, and all the products get mixed up, okay? We know how many kgs I'm delivering, but then my produce gets mixed up with his produce, okay? Then products are bagged, put into bags, and then they finally sent to the industrial markets, okay? So that's how it works. Let's look at the old supply chain before the internet kicked in, okay? We have farmlands that produce products. Then they deliver the products to the market. The market is called the mandi, okay? Transportation from the average, the transportation from the land where they work to the market is 40 to 50 kilometers, okay? They use these means of transportation. Does it take a lot of time and cost to travel along those distances on those roads with these products? Is it an expensive process? It's very expensive, right? But I mean, it takes a lot of effort, okay? Then they take the goods from the field, they take it to the market, and only when they get to the market, they discover the price. So they first make a commitment, and then they discover the reward for that commitment, okay? Am I being clear? Also, they have hardly any weather information, so they don't know when to harvest their field, okay? So they don't know when to harvest because they don't know the weather. They take the goods to the mandi, to the local market, and just hope that the effort in the field, the effort in transportation, ends up paying off. The system is an auction that is supposed to be a fair pricing model, where nobody sets the price. It's just a mix between a match between supply and demand that sets the price. Also, the products are measured; the weight is measured, and however, quality is not measured. They don't measure the quality of my products, and they end up being mixed with his products. Okay. At the markets, we have commission agents that buy the goods. In the auction, these are the sellers, these are the buyers. There are intermediaries. Namely, there are buyers that buy from this large company in India that is called ITC that actually launched the redesign of the supply chain. ITC just tells the commission agent what's the maximum price ITC is willing to pay. What actually happens is that the price in the market is, say, 80. These guys say, well, I'm willing to pay up to 100 because they need to tell their agents how to behave. They need to tell their agents, if the price gets above 100, stop buying. But what actually happens is that if the price in the market is 80, these guys buy for 80 and sell for 100. Okay? Am I being clear? So, at the end of the day, typically a few days later, these guys get paid for their products by these guys, okay? But payment happens at a later stage. These guys pay for transportation. These guys pay for bagging. They pay for each bag of product that is delivered, okay? Let's look at, again, one video that show you how ITC redesigned their supply chain. It works. The video is from the University of Michigan.
Since economic liberalization.
Hopefully.
In the early 90s, India has moved rapidly towards globalization. The shift has radically altered the lives and aspirations of urban India, but it has not touched India's rural two-thirds in the same way. ITC's eChaupal demonstrates the magnitude of the business opportunity while illustrating the social impact of bringing global resources, practices, and remuneration to the Indian farmer. ITC's International Business Division, IBD, buys, processes, and trades agricultural commodities such as soya. Tactically, IBD had an inadequate supply chain. Soya was sold by farmers in government-authorized market yards called mandis. The buyers were agents who acted as middlemen and resold the grain to IBD.
Auction hota tha wahan, khula auction hota tha. Har trolley ke upar vyapari aur mandi ka karmchari jaate the aur wo पांच दस दस पैसे पच्चीस पच्चीस पैसे मतलब बढ़ाती थी, बड़ी शर्माती थी उससे। बड़ी हिंदू हमारी औकात हम 50,000 या 25,000 का इसमें मान लेके आए हैं, ये 25 पैसे उसके, तो हम लोगों को बड़ा गुस्सा भी आता था, लेकिन करें क्या, मजबूर थे उसमें, कोई हमारे पास ऑप्शन तो उस समय था नहीं, ये हालत होती थी उस समय। और उसके बाद फिर व्यापारी अपने घर लेके गया तुलाई, आज भी मंडी हमारी जो मंडी हमारे यहाँ लगती है उसमें तुलाई मंडी में नहीं होती। ऑक्शन हुआ, इसके बाद वो व्यापारी के घर पर ट्रॉले गया, अपना बैग्स भराएंगे, और बैग्स भराने के बाद में फिर तुलाई होती थी वहाँ पे। उसके बाद हाँ कॉस्ट 3 रुपये जो लगती है वो किसान को देनी पड़ती थी। इसके बाद फिर मैनुअल कांटे पर तुलाई हो रही है, तो वो अब एक एक बोरे तोल रहे हैं, निश्चित तौर पर 1 किलो या 1.5 किलो 2 किलो पर क्विंटल का डिफरेंस तो आई। हम लोग अगर तौल के भी ले जाएँ तो भी अगर एक ट्रॉली पे अगर 2 टन हम लेके गए तो गिरी हालत में 20 किलो का डिफरेंस आना है उसमें कम, वो तुलाई में। अब आप समझ सकते हैं कि कांटा मैनुअल कांटा चल रहा है तो वो एकदम जैसा सोना तुलता है उस कंडीशन में तुलेगा नहीं। मैंने कहा ठीक है भाई, सोना थोड़ी है ये, तो चलता है, थोड़ा सा झटका लगा दिया वो बड़े परफेक्ट होते हैं हम माल जो तुलावटी जो जिनको कहते हैं, तो थोड़ा सा झटका
his field for months, then took the product on a tractor, drove some 50 kilometers to the mandi, figured out an auction that feels like not fair. At the end of the day, this is how the quantity gets measured, and you just get the feeling you're not being fully rewarded for the effort you put into your production process.
लगाया वहाँ तो भीड़ लग रही है, 25 ट्रॉलियाँ खड़ी हैं, तो किसान सोच रहा है जितनी जल्दी फुर्सत हो चलता बने, तो इस तरह किसान को बहुत नुकसान होता था। तुलाई हो गई, इसके बाद पैसे के लिए बैठा है, 20,000 का माल हुआ भी 5,000 रुपये ले जा, 8 दिन बाद आके ले जाना बाकी पैसा। ऐसा होता ही आज भी हो रहा है, ऐसा नहीं आज भी ऐसा हो रहा है, ये हालत होती थी पहले।
The first leg of the solution is the e-chowpal, a web-connected PC run by a local farmer called the Sanchalak. Here, farmers can access the IBD rate along with the going rates at several nearby mandis, thus eliminating information asymmetry and allowing the farmer an empowered choice. The second leg of the solution is the IBD processing center, where the farmer delivers his produce.
इससे मास्टर टेस्ट हो जाता है, उस हिसाब से भाव तय करके हम लोग एक पर्ची यहाँ से सैंपल लेके किसान यहाँ आएंगे और यहाँ से वो पर्ची हम लोग इसमें टेस्ट करके देख, तो वहाँ कोई परेशानी नहीं है, मैनुअल कांटा है, इलेक्ट्रॉनिक तौल कांटे पे तुलाई होती है, एकदम पूरा तुलाई हो गया, पूरा ट्रॉली खाली हो गया, पूरा पैसा किसान ने लिया। मुश्किल से पूरे प्रोसेसिंग में 1 घंटा ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा किसान का खर्च होता है।
अच्छा, कैसे क्वेश्चन आते हैं
फार्मर से? ज़्यादातर तो आज वेदर के और रेट का ज़्यादा रहता है, 6:00-6:00 किसान आ जाते हैं। अच्छा। मैं तो इसी रूम में सोता हूँ, तो सुबह 6:00 मतलब किसान ही आके उठाता है मुझे, घर वाले नहीं उठाते सर, मजाक नहीं कर रहा हूँ मैं, किसान ही आएगा, अरे यार भैया तुम सो रहा है, ये गेहूँ देखना है।
इसी में मैं जो है मैक्सिमम टाइम मेरा एक तो सी बोर्ड की रिपोर्ट देखता हूँ मैं, एग्रीवाच का या कुछ किसान वाच, ये शिकागो बोर्ड ऑफ ट्रेड जो है, डेली देखने से उसको उसका एक आइडिया मालूम पड़ता है फ्यूचर ट्रेंड क्या हो सकता है मार्केट का, और उस हिसाब से मैंने यहाँ के किसानों को सजेशन भी दिए हैं और उससे बेनिफिट भी मिला है। ये किसान है, ये अपना माल 1,000 में बेचने के लिए तैयार थे, इनको रोक दिया हमने कि भी अभी माल अभी बेचना नहीं अपने को, वही माल इनका 1,300 रुपये में बिका कुछ दिनों बाद ही। मैंने पीपल रवा में कम से कम 10,00,000 रुपये का बेनिफिट करवाया है केवल सजेशन दे के।
ओके, सो नाउ लेट्स ट्राई टू डू दिस टुगेदर, वी हैव सम टाइम। व्हाट आर द प्रॉब्लम्स विद द ओल्ड सिस्टम, the mandi system, the one, the old one before the e-chowpal initiative from ITC? What were the problems that that supply chain had? Put yourself in the shoes of the farmers. Bargaining power, right? Where does that imbalance come from? Any idea? He says, "What? Basically, the farmers are the weak side, right? Which is the vast majority of the population, and is the side that does the most of the work. But they are weak in this system. Why is that? They don't have information. Which information? Lack of information makes them weak. What sort of information they are missing? prices, right? The thing is, they don't know the price at which they will be selling. They first make the commitment to sell. Basically, they spend all the money to take the goods to the market, and only later they discover the price, right? So it's not only they miss the price information, but they also they have what we call high transaction cost. That is, they incur the cost to have the transaction, the exchange of goods, but they first incur the transaction cost. They load on the tractor, they take the tractor to the mandi, to the local market first. Only later they figure out whether they can find the price that is worth the effort. But once they've spent all those money, basically they're in a position where they have to sell, okay? So the lack of information and the transaction cost on the shoulders of the farmers lead them to have to sell at whatever the condition they find in the market, okay? So that makes them weak. Any other thing that impressed you as not functional in this supply chain? Anything else that's not working properly? Quantity measurement. You know how many kgs of produce you bring to the market, to the mandi, but you don't know for how many kgs you will be paid, right? There's another dysfunctional feature of this supply chain. Another thing that doesn't get properly controlled in the system. Many intermediaries, right? Anything else? Speak up. And what's the problem with quality? Yes, if I have a good quality, I spend a lot of money to buy good seeds, I spend a lot of effort in the field to grow good products, and then in the market my product gets confused with yours, I don't get the rewards for all the investments in quality that I made. So actually the result is not only people don't get rewarded for quality, but people tend not to invest in quality. That leads to poor quality production, okay? So given that you don't get rewards for your quality because it all gets mixed up, what happens is that people don't even care to buy seeds of good quality, okay? So these are the problems. And actually, you can see that your analysis is actually fairly close to mine. Also, there's a feeling of people that are being abused by intermediaries. They're not treated fairly, okay? Let's look at how ITC redesigned the supply chain. First of all, they introduced the Sam Chalak. The Sam Chalak is the leader of the local community, and they install a computer at the Sam Chalak houses, okay? Basically, there's nothing new, just a computer at the house, which is still a big deal because electrical supply is not constant, you have no internet lines, but they spent $5,000 per installation at the Sam Chalak place. What the Sam Chalak delivers is information and training, and also they do quality inspection right up front to teach people how to measure the quality of their production, okay? And the Sam Chalak is only 4 to 5 kilometers far from the people's house or the land, okay? So it's very close. There's plenty of Sam Chalaks. In each single village in India, you have the Sam Chalak, okay? The Sam Chalak gets information from the World Wide Web on weather and prices at the mandi, and also the ITC communicates to the Sam Chalak and to the farmers the maximum price they're willing to pay for. So they know in advance the prices at the mandi in the past and current prices from ITC. Also, what ITC does is to leave the door open for farmers to go through the old system. They don't say, if you work for me, you only need to work for me. You always have the second option. I'll give you just a first option to deal with, okay? So there's still the old way, you're just building a new channel. So far, they built just a channel for information, okay? But then they also built a physical channel that is a facility where ITC gets the product from the farmers. These facilities are still not that widespread. They're still roughly 50 in the country, in the region, sorry. So the transportation cost is still the same. But in this case, ITC pays 50% of the transportation cost. So the transaction is not only on the farmer's shoulder, it's shared cost. Also, the first, consumer, the farmer, sorry, gets the information from the Samchalak on the price that will be paid at the ITC center, because they know in advance their quality, they know in advance the prices that ITC is willing to pay for, and thus they know how much money they will get. Also, at the ITC center, we have electronic measures of weight, first, and also they have a second check on quality, because they want to make sure that the quality that has been measured at the Samchalak place is the same that they get at the receiving station, okay? Interestingly enough, still we have the old commission agents. They didn't take away from the supply chain. When we think about the internet, we always think about the fact that we reduce the number of intermediaries. So we get rid of the intermediaries. But Amazon is a clear example of a situation where you don't get rid of the intermediaries. Simply, the intermediary does a different job. Zappos is another example of a situation where we replace one intermediary with another one, but we don't get rid of the intermediary. In some situation, we do, like in the case of Lowe's weapons for Lego. But in many situations, you don't get rid of the intermediary. Simply, intermediaries do a different job, okay? The old commission agents for ITC are called the Samyojak. The Samyojak does a simple job. He deals with the logistics. He takes care of the transportation and receiving operations and quality inspections at the ITC center, but also the Samyojak, and also pays. But in this case, payment occurs immediately. Just in one, after 1 hour, you get all your money. 100% of the volume you produced, 100% of the quality you produce, and 100% of the money you earned, okay? But the Samyojak does another job. He also delivers good to the farmers. Like he delivers seeds to the farmers. So they, on the one hand, they create wealth for the farmers, but on the other hand, through the Samyojak, they take advantage of the wealth. They turn farmers not only into from suppliers into customers for ITC that nowadays sell them products, okay? One question for you guys. This is the original version of the website through which Samchalak gets weather information, best practices information. That is, for example, what's the distance you have to have between two plants for soya? You have to have 9 centimeters between one plant and the next. They used to have much less than that. They have market information, both from the Mondays, ITC, and international market like the Chicago Exchange. And here are some comments on how farmers felt about this innovation enabled by the internet. I want to mention the fact that it's enabled by the internet, but as you can see, the internet is just one component of it. It's not just an internet innovation. Internet played a role in the total redesign of the supply chain, okay? There is the comment that a farmer made. I was paying the price for my lack of knowledge. Now I get the right price for my crop. ITC has changed my life. These are the benefits we have. But can you please tell me who wins, who loses? Are we transferring wealth, or are we generating more wealth through this innovation? Enabled by technology, but the key idea is that technology is just an enabler of innovation, is not the innovation per se. Who wins, who loses? Are we distributing wealth or are we increasing wealth? Are there losers and winners, or are we creating more wealth for all the players in the supply chain. Farmers clearly win. Is that clear? There's no question. Farmers are winning because they produce more, have an incentive to generate more quality, actually do generate more quality and get better prices. Okay? So there's no question. They are winning. The point I'm trying to make is, though, that the total wealth, welfare, the total value is going up. Given that we produce more with better technology, we know the weather, so we know when to harvest our products. We know how to take care of our products. We know when to take our products to the market. We basically increase the total output, okay, for the system. So overall, not only we are moving money from the commission agents to the farmers, we're making the whole system richer, okay, because we increase volume and quality. Also, let me take you through the another video, okay? What are the benefits of the system? What are the benefits felt by the users of the system?
Bhupen and Kailash are two generations of farmers from Ichnapur. They both belong to the e-Chopal in their village. ITC's internet portal for farmers, e-Chopal, brings them farming advice and updates on weather and market prices. Ashutosh is the Sanchalak of their e-Chopal. Trained by ITC, he is a source of advice for farmers in the area.
जानकारी बढ़ी तो उसको लेकर के काफी परिवर्तन आया जब से 2003 के बाद से आप समझे हर वर्ष में एक नई क्रांति की तरीके से आईटीसी ने जितनी जानकारियां अधिकाधिक उपलब्ध कराई तो हमारे यहां किसान बहुत ज्यादा मात्रा में उसको फायदा मिला है
Since he joined eChopal, Kailash's output and income from farming has gone up threefold. He grows three crops in the year. It is the same for Bhupen and his father, Pishambarna. They now access high-quality seeds, organic fertilizer, and pesticides. They grow soya and maize with the rain, wheat in the winter, followed by lentils.
चौपाल आने के बाद ये हुआ कि हमको यहाँ पे सारी चीज जो चीजें हम बाहर मार्केट से खरीदते थे मान लो खाद था बीज था या अन्य दवाइयाँ हैं कीटनाशक वगैरह खरपतवार नाशक है ये सारी चीजें जो हम बाहर से मतलब लेते थे वो भी डुप्लीकेट होता था ये चौपाल मतलब ये चौपाल आने के बाद में ये सारी चीजें शुद्ध मतलब अच्छी चीजें जो है गुणवत्ता वाली हमें यहीं पर सारी चीजें मिलने लगी और मिलने के बाद में क्या हुआ कि उससे जो है हम लोगों का टाइम बचत हुआ टाइम के साथ साथ में पैसा भी बचत हुआ
Their investment in productivity is fully rewarded in the Hardoi mandi when they sell to ITC. eChopal provides transparent market linkage through the Samyoja, ITC's buyer in the mandi. It is a process that is totally different from what happens elsewhere in the mandi. Selling to ITC ensures that their grain is tested for quality. Electronic weighing guarantees that they get full value for every consignment. And straight after delivery, they receive full payment.
मंडी की अपेक्षा आईटीसी में हमको लाभ हुआ कम से कम 1100-1200 रुपए का उतने ही गेहूं का उतने ही माल का मतलब 1100 रुपए 1200 रुपए हमको हर ट्राली पे अधिक मिला.
ओके, few words and what do you think made it work? Clearly there's wealth creation. I want to point to the fact that the total value has increased because quality has increased, and you can hear them saying our sales, our turnover has increased by 3 times, okay? So total value has gone up. And clearly the commissions and agents were not making 2/3 of the total value, so the total value must have gone up. But what made it work? What are the ingredients that actually made this innovation work? That was enabled by technology, but took a complete redesign of the whole system. What made the eChupal initiative work, from ITC work? The eChupal, by the way, means electronic meeting, because people gather around the computer to get the information on weather and on prices. What do you think made it work? What were the components, the ingredients of success behind the story? Any thought or idea? Is the technology anything special here? Is there anything magic about the technology? They just communicate weather, prices, fairly basic stuff, right? What makes it work? Farmers used to feel abused, and now they feel, you say, empowered. They feel in control of their destiny, because they know that their efforts on price will be, on quality will be rewarded, and they know how much they will make when they take the goods to the market, right, to the ITC market and to the mandi market. Anything else that strikes you as relevant ingredient of this success story? Nowadays we have more than 6,000 different eChupals in the country, so it's been widespread by now. You can check online how many videos and presentation from students from all business schools in the world you can see about this initiative. It's part of the basic course on technology and operations management at the Harvard Business School in these days. This is a standard case of operations management in these days, okay? So it's a very well-known success. But let's figure out what are the ingredients behind it. Speak up. They have fair measures, so they know that they're going to be paid for what they bring to the table, right? So it's a fairer market. Anything else? Why do you think they left the door open for farmers to still go to the mandi? Why didn't they tell the farmers, you can only, if you enter the eChupal system, you should stay with the ITC? They tell, you can get the information from ITC, but still you can choose to go to the mandi, no problem. What do you think that happened? Apparently it doesn't make business sense, right? You put the infrastructure in place, but then you let the farmers go to the mandi. Any? Speak up. Give them the option, right? I'm going to be the first option. So giving them a second option just make them feel that they can choose, and then make them feel it's a fair system. Think about it. It's exactly what Zappos did, isn't it? Zappos said, when we stock out of a given item, we don't try to sell another item to the consumer. We send the consumer to another competitor's website where the product is stocked. We leave the door open for consumers to walk away from us, because we know that's exactly what will bring them back, okay? Anything else that strikes you in the system now as compared to the previous situation that makes it actually work better? Any comment on quality? Is there anything different about quality? So we have better quality of information and better quality of inputs like seeds and better quality of outputs. And you can very well understand with these three ingredients, something actually very good can happen. I just want to mention two ingredients that are less obvious, so I want to briefly touch upon them. The first one is that they rely on a given social infrastructure. Information doesn't need to change the social infrastructure of the villages. They figure out in each single village who's the leader. And they tell, given you're the leader, you're going to be the samchalak. That is the one that is going to be heard and understood and trusted by people. And the samchalak gets a fee for all transactions that the farmers make to ITC. That's very clear and open to everybody. So actually, they introduce more intermediaries because the samchalak is somehow an information intermediary that is rewarded for the traffic that it generates for ITC. Also, we talked about this. They minimize resistance by employing all supply chain members. The commission agents are recycled as some yojak. Again, the intermediaries were there before. They are still there now. They're dealing with logistics, payment, and with the creation of value for the farmers makes farmers richer and lead them to be consumers as well. And the samyojak takes care of farmers as to logistics, as to money, but as to consumption of goods, okay, as well. I just want to, we're running out of time, so I want to just draw some conclusions. So to me, the internet is just an ingredient, a new ingredient for companies and the economy. But it's not a new recipe for success. What I mean is that, think about cooking that is popular in Italy in these days. You just have a new ingredient, but the thing is that ingredient doesn't build a dish. You need new things, a new way, you need to think about cooking in a different way if you want to leverage on the new ingredient. But in order to have a proper dish, you need to have a new recipe that uses this new ingredient. The new ingredient, per se, doesn't create the recipe. You need to put together other things on top of your new ingredient in order to have a new recipe or a new dish. It also takes a new breed of cooks in order to cook the new ingredient properly. Many things that happen in the internet are not manageable by old managers, and actually think that opens a very good opportunity for you guys that actually are natives. And understanding of economic and managerial dynamics can help us identify areas of opportunity and design solution. Like looking at that parking lot, you can see cars, you can see a parking lot, but you can also see a business opportunity where you see a huge idle capacity, a huge idle investment that is not generating any value. And you can figure out ways to create value. In terms of content, these are the things we've seen during the presentation, but given that we talked about this, I don't want to spend time on it. Maybe we have some 5 minutes for, in case there's any question on the topics or economic reading of the internet, the bits and atoms. Okay, are we running out of time? We have 5 minutes. Okay, any question, guys, on the cases and presentation we've dealt with this morning? Go ahead.
Yeah.
can I take questions one by one, or should I take questions and then answer, or should we? Let me take this one. Clearly, we have different beasts, and so we have different perspectives on the same basic phenomenon. Okay, but still, if you think about the Zappos example, the process we went through is there's a business opportunity that is the long tail, and the savings we can do on inventories, on the slow-moving items, on my products where we have a huge variety of items that don't sell that often. But then we said there are design problems. We have to design our system because our customer has got some problems with it. And so we should look at the internet retailing for shoes from the consumer perspective and understand that the consumers do have some problems. And we need to design the system in such a way that we fix those problems, and then figure out how to build a business model around it. It costs to deliver and take the products back for free. But we need to first identify the problem, build the process, and then figure out the business model around the fact that the consumers need to try their shoes on if they want to buy their shoes. So I do think we have different perspectives, but if you carefully look at parts of the presentation, there are situations where you look at it from the consumer perspective and the design of the system around the consumer needs. Zappos, namely. I had a brilliant idea. I would have opened my, those that are good at doing things actually do it. Those that are not that good tend to teach it. But so I had a good idea. I would have opened my own internet company. Having said that, I have to tell you that I think that internet does have given advantages, and long tail and customization are the two very significant dimensions over which you can compete. Okay, the thing is, be careful, because we haven't covered the third point, that is, in those markets, size does matter. So if you try to compete on anything where Amazon is, you tend to have a problem. So you have to walk away from it and enter all those small niches where the giants are not there. One example is the firearms for weapons for Lego, all those niches. Like I used to have a very good collection of orchids, plants with flowers, and we have maniacs in Europe, few maniacs that are willing to spend fortunes on those plants. If you build a very good system for that, then probably you have a business opportunity, but it won't be, don't try to compete head on with Amazon on the economies of scale, on inventories, they will kill you, variety, they will kill you. And the second thing is, regardless of what the product is, learn the Zappos lesson. That is, they call themselves Zappos from the Spanish word that is zapatos, referring to shoes. But don't think about the product per se, only the product. The product is just part of the recipe, because internet does have problems, and you need to look at it from the consumer perspective. You know, the Zappos story, interestingly, back to your question about the consumers, the whole story about the Zappos started with the founder, which is not the current CEO, the founder trying to buy a pair of shoes and not finding the pair of shoes he wanted at brick and mortar stores. The whole story started from there. A basic bad customer experience, okay? And when you're into something that is not actually the shoes, but the customer experience, or you have some knowledge that something is not working properly, then you have the opportunity to go try and fix it. Okay? Any? Competition does help a bit. I haven't talked about it, but there are legal consequences. The Mandi were the only market by law. ITC had to get permission from the government to open this secondary channel. So there are legal issues around it as well. So you don't need to only figure out the technology, not only the supply chain, but the legal side of it as well. And actually, the Mandis do face competition from another channel, and they have to work better. because people do have the option. Actually, the story was started with soya. Nowadays, they have built channels for different products in India. There was enough? There was an extra question, then we're done. Let's look at Amazon, for example. It's one clear example. Amazon is clearly an intermediary, right? It was born as a retailer. Nowadays, it's no longer a retailer on the internet. It's a sort of a mall. Do you know what the mall is? A shopping center. Now, at Amazon, you don't only see products sold by Amazon. You see products being sold from other retailers. So nowadays, they're like a gigantic internet shopping mall where the Amazon product is what, and the Amazon service brings people to the Amazon website. But then once you're on the website, you can buy products from other retailers. And it's exactly what happened with shopping malls. In shopping malls, people are led to come to the shopping malls by supermarkets, Zara stores, electronic stores, anchor stores, that's what we call anchor stores, but then we end up buying ice cream for our kids when we are at the shopping center, right? So Amazon started as a retailer and turned into a shopping center. Where they are Amazon is both the manager of the shopping center and the anchor store. But then you have all these other small stores that enjoy the traffic of people that the Amazon service and the Amazon brand brings to the shopping center. Okay, so that's a totally new business. Also, they're entering the logistics system. They're investing in logistics in these days. They're no longer only a retailer. They're becoming a supply chain company on top of information services and blah, blah, blah. The other retailers? Well, I'm not sure. Amazon clearly gets the most of the benefits, but I guess when you have a gigantic, imagine you're in a city, you have a gigantic mall, and probably you want to open a store at the mall. Probably the mall manager will ask you to pay a dear price, but basically that's the only option left to it. So I guess we have to stop here. Thank you for your attention.